Hi, welcome to the Social Nerdcast, Episode 8. I am your host, the illustrious Alex motherfucking Henderson. And to my left, the one, the only, the digital form of hashtag Gumby Nation, the man, the one and only fan we have.
It's not true.
As well as now, an official social nerd, Adam Gumbert. How you doing, Adam? Hey,
man, I'm doing great. It's good to finally be on. It's only like a year in the making, but...
Man,
good.
I think it's been longer than that.
That might have been.
You know, it's because I know you're the... Now, you may not be the only one. Now, let me scratch that. I know you're not the only one who listens to the show, because I know there's other people, but I'm pretty sure I know everybody else who listens to the show. Like, their personal friends. What?
Numbers are numbers, man.
That's true. So, now there may be others, but they don't talk to me on Twitter, so that's their own problem. Yeah, they could
I'm the most social of these social nerds. That's probably true.
They could be on the show right now if they wanted to. You know what? Well, you're special, so they'd probably be more work for me to do it to them, but my point is, if you want to be on the show, talk to me on Twitter for a year.
Yes, it'll happen eventually.
It'll happen. lost my train of thought. Anyway, so, since you're, this is why I love podcasting, is because you can just lose your train of thought and it doesn't matter, because it's...
Absolutely.
Everything's fine. I had this whole thing going, and I was going to talk about how great you were.
Well, I mean, if people want to look me up...
That's true.
It's The Mic Kings. THEMICKINGS. It's my podcast that I do. So, and you guys can check me out there if you want to look me up.
Oh, I did. I forgot to say before the show. So this is very much me to you, Adam.
Okay.
As you know, or you may not have noticed, or you very well may have, I talk a lot, which is why I want to do a podcast. And so I usually am the one talking the most in this show. So I am sorry if I talk too much or I accidentally talk over you. Just tell me to shut up.
You're good.
It just keeps rolling. So yes, he has a much better show than this. And he actually records regularly. So
I will get on you for that. But you're getting better, so it's all good.
I'm trying. It's just so hard.
It's
so much better now, though, because, like, I told you before the show started. There were so many pieces, and everything was messed up. Like, really, when I started podcasting, I literally was just like, I want to do this because that seems cool. Yeah. And all I knew, like, I didn't even know where to record stuff on the computer. I just saved up some money for a microphone, and with a friend of mine, Sebastian, my Vietnamese co-pilot, and we bought a microphone and then just tried our best.
It's a little different because you do the video thing, which is more work than I want to do, but once you make yourself start doing it, it gets easier, but podcasting is the best. Love it.
It is super great. So now his is not nerd focused, it's life focused. Which is just so interesting because now I don't really talk to you much about your show specifically. You know, we go back and forth sometimes in messages, but this is even the first time we've actually talked face to face, you know, so to speak.
Yeah.
But I started listening to your show, like literally the first episode, and I was like, this guy is the only one I know of that's even remotely supported me, who I'm not related to. So I have to listen to his show, but like I would listen to it and I was like, man, you know, I actually like hearing these people's stories. And then a year later, it's kind of strange, but I find it incredibly interesting that I've had this window into the lives of these 5 to 6 people that I've never met in my entire life. And, you know, probably will meet. Someday I'm going to find my way to Kentucky. You're going to find your way to Texas.
We'll figure it out.
But, you know, like, a year ago, I never knew, you know, Kylan existed or David or... By the way, this is a specific shout out. You need to have Alex Gomez on your show more often.
Dude, I'm with you. Gomez is the best.
He every time he gets on there, he talks about something that I'm passionate about, and it makes me so happy. Because, like I remember, every time a DC movie comes out, he comes on and, like, spits some truth, and I'm just like, yes.
Dude, I'll tell him. He's literally my roommate. It's just that he's always sleepy. He's like, I'm going to bed. I'm like, all right.
Tell him to get his act together.
Oh, I'll tell him to get on there just for you. He'll probably get on there next couple weeks.
But you know what I mean? And because your show is a lot, it's about your guys' life. It's not, you know, like ours, we don't talk about anything important, you know, we just talk about nerdy stuff and video games, and we have fun doing it, and that's the point, is we have fun, and I hope that there's other people out there other than you who listen to it and have fun too. That's the whole reason we do it. But your show is like, I don't know, not to make too much of it if you know, you don't think too much of it, but it's like humanity, in a sense, because it's your lives, and that's what you talk about. It's not... I mean, granted, you throw in some stuff in there about, you know, video games and movies and stuff like that, because that's your lives and that's what you do. But I do find it's strange how much I know about all these people who a year ago didn't even know they existed. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Kylan said the same thing. He was like, he has people come up to him that are just like, we never knew that stuff about you, but he says it on the podcast, but he's known these people for years and he's never told them these stories or these things about himself. So podcasting just... I mean, like you said, you can listen to people and you feel like you know them, even though you might have never met them before. So that's just how it happens.
And it's going to be weird because I know someday I'm going to meet you guys and I'm going to be like, hey, you know, Kylan, I know like all of these things about your past relationships and your interests and everything. And I'm just going to be
weird.
I know, it's because like I know so much about him. It's like we're best friends, but he, I mean, probably has seen... like my picture on Twitter.
Like he knows what you look like, and it's like, but yeah, you know all the most embarrassing parts of his life, just, and it's all out there.
Anyway, so I can't speak highly enough about the Mike Kings, and also they're always good to you. Well, you know, you're always the best on, even when we're not making shows, still giving us shout outs. And it's actually really funny because I listen to your show every week, as I told you, and Sebastian, who's a dick, and nobody likes him, and we talk crap about him all the time on the show if you listen to it, audience, and he never listens to the show, and he doesn't even edit it anymore, so he'll never know, because
he has no idea.
When he's on the show, he sees what goes on there, and then he's just blackout. And then he'll come back on later. And he used to edit it, so we'd talk shit about him. And he'd be like, you guys aren't cool, man. But now I edit it on my computer, so he has no clue. So we can talk as much shit as we want. So Sebastian sucks.
Yeah, if you remind me, I'll talk shit about Sebastian on my podcast real quick. I'm like, man, Sebastian's an asshole. Just keep going.
So Sebastian's an asshole. And he's 99% of the reason why the Social Nerds has faults. And everything, he's what's wrong with America today.
Oh, Lord.
So, but I was talking to him, and I had told him, like, I was just talking about your show, because I think it was some funny story I had heard that you guys were talking about, or this or that. And then, I had told him that he was, like, at the end of the show, you were like, Social Nerds, stop it, get your shit together, I'm tired of not having shows. And then he felt so bad about himself, because he was like, in his head, the one guy who actually cared, we were just failing him completely, and he was blatantly yelling at us via the internet to come and make shows, and we just wouldn't do it. And he, for like a week, he was like, man, I'm such an asshole. And I was like, yeah, you are, Sebastian, you sure are.
I'm going to get some of my friends and make them listen, because I know people who will listen. I'm going to make sure that they download it and then call out Sebastian and you guys. Just keep that going. So it's multiple people.
So I'm going to tell you a real funny story about Sebastian.
All right.
And I don't know. I may get in trouble for this legally.
No, you'll be fine.
But I think I'll be okay. So And it has to do with talking shit about Sebastian, because I love to do it. It's a lot of fun. I'm not like, he's not like a battered friend. We're very good friends, but we're so good friends that I talk shit about him and he thinks it's not funny. So, like a year ago, maybe more, we were in a movie. And you may have heard of it. It's the Rooster Teeth movie they did, the Laser Team. I don't know if you've seen it. Mm-hmm. We were extras in that movie.
Oh shit. Is there like, can you point out where you are?
Yes, I can. Specifically, I'm in there for a second, and it's you can see Sebastian blatantly twice in the movie, like straight up there he is in like focus, and then the scene that I'm in, I'm outside, at this party scene that they do, and he's in and like they're one of the dudes from I think Game Grumps is getting in a fight. He's one of the main characters in the movie who talks a lot of shit. The littler guy, he gets punched. And as soon as he goes down, I'm right behind him, just, like, cheering.
So good.
And I, so, what had happened is my friend, Berto, who may come in later in the show, he's a big fan of Rooster Teeth, and I like, you know, I watched, Red vs. Blue a lot, but I don't really follow their YouTube stuff, not for any particular reason, you know, I just...
Yeah, I'm with you.
I don't even watch... it doesn't matter. So, I don't really follow their YouTube stuff, but he was like, oh, I really want... they're doing this movie, and they're based in Austin, and we live fairly close to Austin. So they were like, they were doing open casting for extras, and they wanted to go. But they are not the most sociable of the social nerds. Mm-hmm. And I very, very much am. So, they wanted me to go sort of as like a... I don't know, someone to talk for him, I guess. I don't know how to say it.
Yeah, like their crutch.
Yeah, just to give him the confidence to really go out there. And then we go there, and if you don't watch the video, I am an extremely large white guy with like 3-foot dreadlocks. So I'm very distinguishable, we go in there, and they were looking for, like, military people, which I am not. But they were, and I think that's what they both ended up being casted in the role that they were looking for. Whereas the casting, the director for the extras took a liking to me and was like, oh my god, we need to take a picture of you right now. Let's go. You look amazing. And I was like, oh, thank you. So, but they both got hired, and I didn't, and I was like, well, I didn't expect to, they're looking for military dudes, but then we got an email, me and Sebastian, later, saying, hey, we're filming this party scene, and we need people who look like they're about 16 to 18, and we're like, yeah, okay, and, so we drive up to Austin, fill out some paperwork and stuff, and they had rented out this house. And see, this is why I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, because I feel like I'm not supposed to, because people don't talk about this, but maybe I don't know. I don't care. Rooster Teeth doesn't watch my podcast. Now, the way movies work, because you don't know this, or I didn't, is everything is a lie in a movie. Everything. Okay. They were at this party, and it was supposed to take place around summertime. However, they filmed it in one of the coldest winters Texas has ever had.
Of course.
So, it was about midnight to 1 a.m. And we start filming because it had to be nighttime. When this happened, it was about midnight to 1 a.m. However, we started filming earlier. But it gets dark kind of late in Texas. So it's crazy cold. However, it has to be summer. So there's all these people out here just dying. And they can't even put on their jackets because it doesn't fit with the movie. So there's like piles of coats because you have to take it off when they film for like, you know, these 20-minute stretches. And then go put them on and try to warm up. But we get there and set everything up. And they start pulling people to set them up and put them where they want in the scene. And then me and Sebastian were lined up together in this big line of people. And they were the first, like, 20 people, they were put inside of the house as, you know, the indoor partiers. And the indoor had heating, so they were assholes.
Oh, man.
Whereas, so I was supposed to go in, but I guess they needed one more chick, so they pulled someone, a girl, out from the line, and then was like, okay, everyone else is outside. But Sebastian had already been chosen to be indoors, so I was insanely angry that he got to be in the nice heated room, whereas I had to be outside in the horrible bitter cold. So... now we well now they start putting us places, and they had these giant kegs that because it was supposed to be a kegger, and they had put root beer in the kegs, which was funny, because I just drank root beer all night. But the casting director, the person like set everything up, not the actual director of the movie, saw my dreadlocks, and was like, "Oh my God, you're perfect! I need you to stand at the keg and fill everyone's cups, and when they come by, I need you to ask them if they want weed." Because nice. Which was weird, because I don't have, like, lines in the movie, but I guess they just wanted me in character, so every person who came up, I was like, "Do you want some weed?" And everybody thought I was being serious, so they were either like, "Yes," or they were like, "No, thank you."
Good. Wow. Damn.
So, but to get to the point of the story, so the entire night, all the people who are outside, they're constantly sending them to me, because I'm the one running the keg, and the sociable person I am, I'm talking to all of them. And every single one I saw, I was like, man, fuck Sebastian. Because I was like, there's my friend Sebastian, he gets to be inside, I don't, fuck that guy. And I think he became like a scapegoat for everyone who was outside in the cold, and they were all like, yeah, fuck Sebastian, that guy who gets to be in there, inside, with all the actors and the warmth, fuck that guy. So after about halfway through shooting, and we're all freezing to death, they set up these giant tents with like these industrial-grade heaters that we would all go sit in to kind of warm up and not die. Just all the outside people are in this one tent, and then the inside people start filtering in, and I had been pointing to Sebastian through the window, and when he had walked in, like, I swear, like, 60 people just turned and started chanting, fuck Sebastian, to his face.
That is so good. That is amazing.
And he was like, what did I do? And I was just like, fuck you, Sebastian, you got to be inside. And everyone was like, yeah, fuck you, fuck Sebastian. It was the best thing ever.
That is so good.
So.
Man. Amazing. I love it.
Thank you. I'm glad I got to share that story with you.
No, it's very good.
Mr. Gumby. All right. So let's talk about video games.
Yeah.
Now, our last show we did was recorded immediately after the Nintendo Switch reveal event. Okay, so I just got a text from my brother Ted, my twin. And he said, tell Gumby I said what's up and fuck Sebastian.
Dude, awesome. So good. Tell him what's up and fuck Sebastian. That's just the thing now.
Yep. Fuck Sebastian. Just everyone what's you up? Know, just say fuck Sebastian.
You're like, what's up, fuck Sebastian?
Our last show was a Nintendo Switch reveal. We recorded it right after, so we were just insanely hyped on it. Even though the show... Now, I liked the show. Everyone else in the world, including my brother Ted, really didn't get a kick out of it. However, I thought it was very good. Not very good, but I liked it. But it was Japanese, you know? Like, what do you expect?
Yeah.
Sorry. But afterwards, Ted had said in the previous show that he was like, where are the games at? And that's not a lot. And I was like, man, everything is great and the world is awesome. So I wanted to take a step back from that. And we've had a couple weeks now, maybe a week and a half, I don't know. Time is an illustrious mistress. And just kind of, I had time to collect myself, and I'm sure you did as well, Mr. Gumby.
Yep.
And I wanted to talk about our opinions on the Switch now that we've had some processing time and really try to give an honest opinion where we, where at least I am not freaking out because of how much stuff that they released.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your opinions? Because I feel like I've talked way too much already.
Oh, yeah, you're good. My opinions is the presentation wasn't great. I didn't go as far on the hate as everyone else was going. I think it's a good and a bad thing. Like, if they do it right, it could be really good and really successful. But I feel like they're also close to being following the same track as the Wii U. Because, like, for me, I owned a Wii U. And I feel really burned after owning that. Like, I played, like, 3 games on it. And they were really good. But I was like, I bought a $300 machine for 3 games. Like, that's kind of ridiculous. I like those games a lot. But I was just like, it's whatever. The Switch, I mean, the main thing is that they have Zelda. Yeah. As a launch title, and that's a huge deal. Like, that's going to move all the 13 million Wii U owners that have the Wii U now are going to want to try to get Switches for that game, straight up. So yeah. That's a great thing to have. They've slowly been announcing more and more launch games as time has gone on, that you've probably paid attention to.
Yeah, very
much. What do they have? It's like Shovel Knight, and then there's been a lot of smaller...
I probably should have looked it up. That's my fault, but...
You can look it up right now while I'm talking. That's fair. Probably a list of some launch stuff. My thing is, everyone's like, they need third-party support. We know how Nintendo is with third-party support. They don't rely on it because people, like, let's be honest, like, who's only going to buy a Switch and not have a PlayStation or an Xbox? Like, if you want to play third-party, you're going to play it on those other systems. What they need to do is get their Nintendo games out, and they need to be good. Because the Wii U had Nintendo games... like, every 3 or 4 months. It was like, okay, that's, like, maybe fill in some, like, you know, some, like, Japanese RPGs that aren't Nintendo, but, like, fill in those spaces. But my problem was that they'd have every three or four months, but I didn't care. Because it'd be, like, Star Fox Zero, didn't really like it. Mario Tennis, that Mario Tennis wasn't good. Mario Party, didn't like it. Like, if they give us good quality games and then fill in the... kind of like how the Vita is, how the Vita's a lot of, like, indie games, but they're really good. Fill us up with that, and then give us the bigger ones every once in a while, and just keep it going. Because, like, if you get past the first year with Zelda and Mario, and then if you're, I guess technically at the end of year one, you're like, okay, Pokemon is coming to Switch, a real-ass Pokemon game, I think you can keep that going. You got to get people to that point of wanting Pokemon on it still.
That's, exactly. I think, Oh, I have the list of the launch games. So, before I do my opinions on it, I will say that it's 1-2 Switch, which I think looks cool. Now, I want to talk a minute for about 1-2 Switch.
Okay.
Because 1-2 Switch gets a lot of hate. And a lot of people, and this is an honest opinion that I've heard and seen, is a lot of people are like, I'll play it once or twice, like, you know, get drunk and duel some people and have some fun. And yeah, you know, that's probably what's going to happen for some people. But I think the 1-2 Switch is being greatly diminished. Because I think this is going to be a very, very common theme among Nintendo Switch owners, is you're going to have 2 games. You're going to have one, and it's just going to be like when the Wii launch, you're going to have 1-2 Switch, which is like, I'm going to take my Switch over to my friends' houses. And it, like, all the people I know, strangers on the street, I'm just going to be like, check this out. And I'm going to play 1-2 Switch because I'm going to be like, look what this thing can do. We both have a controller. We can duel. We can count balls.
Yeah.
And, you know, goof around and have a good time. And then, which, by the way, the drinking games alone for 1-2 Switch are going to be phenomenal. Like,
oh, yeah.
I am going to get hammered playing that game. So, but besides the point, but that's the thing where you're like, look at all the cool stuff that we can do, and look at all these weird controllers and all this stuff, and let's milk some cows. And then, so you show them that, and they're like, look what you can do with it. Look at all the things this machine can do. And then you show them Zelda, and you're like, look what you can play on it. This right here is wherever you go portable. And then, like, that, like, no pun intended, but they have that, it's like it's that 1-2 punch of, like, you have this, like, casual thing, but is, like, I think interesting enough to get people, like, Wii Sports is a lot simpler. Like, you know, you're like, hey, you're play tennis. Whereas this, you have to be like, you're milking a cow. Don't worry, it's fine. But you show them that and you play that and they go, wow, I want to get this. This seems like we're having, like, granted, I don't know, you know, maybe some people enjoy it for less extents and less time periods than I will. But at any rate, the first time you play that game, you're going to have a good time. Yeah. And any person I show that to, they're going to be like, oh, I wish I could do that. You know, that's going to be a positive experience playing 1-2 Switch. And they're going to be like, I want to get that. I want to play 1-2 Switch with people like that guy just did. That crazy stranger who ran up to me on the street and was like, let's milk some cows. And then you'd be like, and I'm about to go play Zelda, and it's this crazy, huge open world and amazing, and all Zelda games are great, and this one's going to be even better. So 1-2, that's my 2 cents on 1-2 Switch. I think it's going to be, seems to be underrated, and no one is giving it the love I think it's going to get when it comes out. The Binding of Isaac Afterbirth Plus,
which... Yep. People like it. I never was into it. It's really good roguelike. So yeah. That's good to have. They're like, that's a necessary game to have there. That's not going to sell units, but for someone who's going to buy it, they're going to be like, oh, I like this game. Let me get this.
This is really cool. You know, and like you said, the Switch is going to be a second console for most people. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people do like they like that game and, you know, the idea of playing it on the go. I'll get into that in a second, but, like, that's going to be enough for them to probably even buy it again just so they can play it wherever they want to.
Yeah.
Just Dance 2017. Sure.
Games always do, so.
Human Resource Machine. I have no idea what that is.
I pay attention. I don't even know what the hell that is.
I Am Setsuna.
Which and is people were really into that. Yeah, that was a big Vita crowd game, so... Yeah. Let's say good Japanese RPG that'll take up a lot of time for people who put into it.
The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, which we...
Of course.
Yeah. Little Inferno.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know what that is. Skylanders Imaginators. Yay. If you like Skylanders.
It's Skylanders. If you like it, you'll like it.
I think I did hear... maybe it was last E3 or the one before, but I remember they talked about that even though it's so old, but they said Wii and Wii U, but like the Wii and Wii U versions of Skylanders sold better than like the Xbox One and the PS4 versions. Now they lumped in Wii and Wii U, but still no one bought it. Some people buy it on Wii U, but the point
it's
is
like the Wii version. That's what they're saying.
The Nintendo crowd, I would like according to that, and my memory of it, like Skylanders more than anybody else. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, my thing with that is that the Wii, there's 100 million of them out there, and a lot of kids, like, your parents are like, here, I got this Wii for $80 at GameStop. Play your Skylanders right here.
Yeah. So. Super Bomberman R, which looks dope.
That does look good. I'm ready for new Bomberman. It's been a while.
Yeah. Sebastian, he is so hyped on that game, it's a little funny. Because I never really played, like, Bomberman. I don't even know if I've ever played a Bomberman game ever. And,
it's an arcade game.
He never talked about it before. And then in that presentation, they showed Bomberman, and he just lost his shit. And I was just like, whoa, calm down, man. What's going on? And he was like, it's Bomberman. And now Sebastian is, like, one of the, like, he's a very, very hardcore kind of gamer guy. If it's not as hard as Dark Souls, he really doesn't even like messing with it. Or unless it's, like, crazy competitive.
Yeah.
And to find out he likes this, like, goofy, you know, arcade kind of, like, old school. Like, he doesn't ever mention an old school game he likes, ever.
And Bomberman.
Yeah, but then they show a Bomberman and he fucking loses shit. So Bomberman R, gonna be cool. Do you know if they've announced if that's coming to other consoles or not? I don't know if it's a Switch exclusive.
I haven't heard anything about other consoles. I'm not really sure. I just heard about the Switch thing, so who knows?
World of Goo, which I'm pretty sure that is a... That's old. It was a DS title or it was a WiiWare title, one of the two.
I feel like it was on. It might be. It was. Yeah, I know that it was. It's like a game that used to, that's already been out, but people like that game, so.
And then these are either March or spring games, so either in the launch month or in the very launch window. So,
yeah.
ARMS, which, mm-hmm. I haven't played it because I'm in no way large like that, but I hear it's very good.
Which one is that?
The fighting game.
ARMS. Like, yeah, I'm not interested in ARMS at all. I mean, it looks interesting, I guess, but I would not pay $60 for that.
Yeah.
That's just me.
I think, like, now, me and Ted both pre-ordered Switches, like, the next day. We both got them pre-ordered. I think if we didn't, I wouldn't want to get ARMS, because the controllers are so expensive, that if you really want to play that locally, you have to go spend $80 on a second set of Joy-Cons.
Yeah, it's not worth it for just one game.
Yeah, you'd have to spend $60 on the game, and unless you're only going to play online, you have to go spend another $80 just to play with people, and that's no way worth it. So, and I totally agree with that. But since we're in a situation where right next to each other, we both have Switches, we can play it together, no problem. I'm in a much more... And we had talked about that at length, just together, about how I can see... Like, a lot of people are complaining about the prices, which the prices are outrageous for all of the peripherals, but... they were complaining about how they have to buy this stuff, and I was like, I don't really see that. You don't have to buy anything. Mm-hmm. If you want to get the console and some games, you can get the console and games. But then I tried to think about it a little bit more on their side, and I was like, well, I guess, like, we are going to have 4 Joy-Cons, you know? So if we want to play, like, 4-player Mario Kart, we can. If we want to play a 2-player split-screen game like that, we can, because we're... And not a lot of people are in that situation where they have someone, like a friend or a family member, right there.
Yeah. What would be smart is they won't do it because it's the launch of the console, but how, after a few years, that a Wii Play game just came with the controller? Like I said, you won't do it now because it's at launch, but like if you're like, the Joy-Cons are $80, but here's ARMS.
I think the peripheral prices are going to get cut fairly quickly. In my personal opinion, I think it's like, that is the one thing that, like, everyone seems to have a defense for just about everything wrong with the Switch. And some of them I agree with, some of them I don't. But the one thing that is universally, like, that is not okay, is everything is just outstandingly high in price.
Oh, yeah. It's absolutely ridiculous.
And I think So I think whenever Nintendo sees that, now granted, they're selling, so... If they keep selling like that, I'm sure they won't care.
That's what I'm saying, because the hardcore people who get it at launch are going to pay those prices. They're going to complain, but they're still going to buy it.
Like, I think the Pro Controller... I don't mind the Pro Controller that's $70. Mm-hmm. Because it's $10 more than an Xbox One controller, and that does suck. But the battery life, or, you know, PS4 controller, the battery life is insane. It's 40 hours.
Yeah.
It has the HD rumble and whatever. Now, if you don't know, I'm an insane Amiibo collector. I just finished my Smash set the other day. I was very, very proud of myself. Of all the ones that aren't out yet, because there's the 3 that aren't. But they're all US, and I did not pay more than retail for any of them. I'm very proud of that.
Nice.
But I finished that, and as someone who, like, big fan of Amiibo, it has the NFC reader right there. You know, I don't need to go grab, you know, like, the Joy-Con or the console itself, or, you know, in the case of the Wii U, have this giant fucking gamepad just to scan in an Amiibo. So, those advantages, I think, are worth the $10. I don't like paying it, but I understand it's worth.
But, yeah, that's the thing. Like, you're going to. Like, they know anyone who gets it at launch wants a Pro Controller, they're going to pay $70. Like, it is what it is.
I don't think it's the $10, in a $10 markup. Maybe a $5. And it just looks bad compared to the competition. But, like, the $80 for 2 Joy-Cons, that's ridiculous. Never do that.
Yeah, that's one, but that's a whole other thing. But what do we got after ARMS?
Has-Been Heroes, which looks cool. Mm-hmm. The developer is a Trine. It's like a lane-based RPG. I'm going to get it. Mario Kart 8 Deluxe. So if you're one of the many people who don't own a Wii U or own a Wii U and like Battle Mode, you're going to buy that game. I know quite a few people who have Wii U's and they're a little bummed that it's $60 because they bought that game already. And like, I bought that game for, well, I got my Wii U when Mario Kart came out and I got the bundle.
So yeah, me too. That's when I got it.
Yeah, I can't say I bought it, but I mean, I did buy it. It was, I bought the Wii U.
How many people remember the DLC, the season pass, quote unquote, was what, $10, like $12? Yeah. It was stupid cheap.
The DLC was super cheap. And this has a bunch of other stuff in it, but I can see them being like, it's an old game that I've already bought. Now, most people haven't bought it because the Wii U didn't sell. But I can see that. Maybe it should have been maybe cut by like $10 just to show, just as more of like a principle thing of, yeah, this is an old game. So anyway, man, my phone is being a dick. Puyo Puyo Tetris.
Mm-hmm. People like that. I've never played it, but apparently it's like who are into that stuff or think it's amazing.
I've seen a couple Let's Plays for it. It looks like fun, and me and I think it's only like $40 on Amazon. So
Tetris.
Yeah, I'll probably get it just because I love Tetris, and me and Ted will play it and have a good time. And then Snipper Glips, Cut It Out Together, which.
People who have played it said that's like probably going to be one of the best games that like no one knows about, but they say Snipperclips is really good.
And you should probably go look up a trailer for it or something because it's awesome, and it does look really cool. I don't know how much time, like I'm gonna play it and I'm gonna beat it, but I want to know like how much is there, because I don't like. It's gonna be cool. And I'm going to like it, and it's probably going to be like $20, and it's going to be awesome, but, you know, it looks like the kind of game that I'm going to run, I'm going to power through in an afternoon, and then that'll be it, and I'm hoping maybe they'll have, like, an online thing or something like that. I don't know, I'm just talking out loud, but...
Yeah.
And that's it for the launch lineup and window. However, special shout-out to the greatest game of all time, Splatoon 2.
Which is just Splatoon with some DLC, pretty much.
Yeah, but it's amazing.
It is good. Now, let's say, it's a decent lineup.
I fucking love Splatoon, so I just...
People like Splatoon. That's the thing about this first year, is that these are games... Zelda is... What people don't understand who are hardcore gamers like us is that we think that we are the main audience, but the casual audience is the ones who actually sell consoles.
And
so
the casual audience doesn't buy games constantly... All the time, you know. Well, like, it's just the hardcore. Like, I want everything, everything. So I think that lineup is perfectly fine for someone who, you know. Now it there is problems. You know, there's holes. Yeah. There's no third parties or none of it.
No sports games.
Yeah, that it's got that 2K though.
Eventually, at the end of the year.
Yeah,
but like that's what I tell people, is like, me and you, we're hardcore. We'll play it all, but like. For when mom goes in the store and it's like, my kid wants it, she's like, there's Zelda, boom. Christmas time, Mario, boom.
That's
when Pokemon Sun and Moon came out, dude, you can't buy a 3DS anymore. They're gone. Like, I'm telling you, when they need to hit on those big games, but
that's what I think.
Sucks, but whatever.
I think a lot of people who are down on the overall lineup of the year, I think when you really, like, next year when we look back, and you're gonna be able to say you got a brand new Zelda, you got a brand new Mario, you got the best rendition of Mario Kart ever made, you got a brand new Splatoon. You know, these are all like big giant titles, and you're gonna have them all in a 6 month, well, 8 month period. That's a good story to have. And that first, now granted, the first year is very sparse, but whenever people look back on 2017 of Nintendo, they're not going to say, oh, what about, I didn't get to play Call of Duty on my Switch because they weren't going to play it there anyway. They're going to be like, man, it was like all of the best games came out in that 1 year. Because every year, you know, no one is like, oh, wow, what came out in, you know, September? They're like, they talk about it as like, whoa, last year was great because I got this, and I got this, and I got this. And you're going to be able to say, I got all of these really great things from Nintendo. And I think that a lot of people, that escapes them. Because, it's sparse, but they have the hitters, like, and especially at the holidays, because we listen to the same people, and I don't know if I want to say specific names, but I'm sure anyone who even possibly listens to this will know who I'm talking about. But the from launch to holidays, it's sort of like a trial period, and it is like the beta testers, which I'm stealing that phrase. And I think like the real like launch is gonna be at the holidays.
Yep.
And that's like the Zelda and the launch is for the hardcore audience, the Wii U owners out there who want to play Zelda on the new system and they want to get it as fast as possible and they want to buy it as fast as possible. But for everybody else, they're gonna get it this holiday and they're gonna be like that, you know, the people, them folk out there.
Yeah, the casuals.
Yeah.
We call them casual, but they make up like 80% of the market. So. Yeah.
The hardcore casuals. They buy most of their stuff on the holiday season anyway, so they're not going to be clamoring to buy a Switch from, like, right now. Unless, you know, well, tax return season's going to be good. I'm sure that's going to sell them. But it doesn't matter. That's financials and business. But that's going to be, like, I think, like, even, like, their marketing, I think, will be, like, compared to what it is at launch of the Nintendo Switch, I bet it'll be even more this holiday season. Because at that point, they're going to be able to say, look at all this stuff you can buy right now. And a lot of people want that at launch, but or at least closer to launch. And I really don't, because I want time to play Zelda, and then I want time to play Splatoon, and I want time to play these things. Now, granted, there's a lot more time than I would want in between those. But this holiday season, whenever they're going to have... I'm sure they'll probably have, like, a Mario bundle or something like that. And they're going to be like...
Yeah, they better.
Yeah. You can get that, and then you can get all this stuff. It's going to look really good at the end of the year. And I think that'll be a lot more of, like, what people have in their heads is what the launch should be.
Yeah.
Compared to what it is now. Because they, I think they are just trying to get it out for Zelda and for the hardcore audience who want this thing now and as soon as possible. And in their heads, they're probably like, it's done. You know, well, our online is crappy, but we'll figure it out. And Zelda's done for it. Everything's good. We really just kind of have some kinks to work out. But hell, let them pay us money for it. And they're happy, we're happy, and who cares?
So yeah, they'll sell like 1 million to 2 million in the first couple months, and then Christmas will hit, and they'll probably be really low on stock for a while. So if Mario is as good as it should be, that will sell. That's what sells consoles. Kids like, hey mom, I want Mario, and Zelda's also out. And mom's like, there you go. Like, that's how it's gonna work. Like, those early adopters like you, I'm probably gonna wait till Christmas, to be honest. But like for the early adopters, like, you're gonna have your stuff to do it. And right now it doesn't look good, but like I said, give it a year and a half. That's when people are going to start catching on. Hopefully, if Nintendo plays it smart, they'll be fine. But if they do it like with Wii U, where it's like they were supposed to have a bunch of stuff and it kept, like, didn't really come out, and then third parties are like, you didn't sell enough, we're not here anymore. They're, like I said, they're on the line of, you know, getting back to probably selling, like, I don't know, like a decent, like, tens of millions of consoles, and then they're also on the line of, like, selling 10 million. So they need to play it right, but this holiday is when you're going to know if it's going to be a thing or not.
Yeah, I think, like, by this time next year, if we're still saying, Nintendo, make better decisions, that's when you're like, oh, okay, this is bad. But this holiday season, I think, is going to be, like, a really big proving ground for them. Mm-hmm. And I think, because I do have problems with the Switch, and maybe that'll be the last thing I talk about for this topic, is my problems with it, because I do like to stay positive about it, because I am very excited about it. I am very positive about it. But there's a couple points I wanted to make specifically, because I don't hear a lot of people making these points, and I think they're very good points. The pointest of points, as they say. Is that, one, a lot of, like, I'll use this example, and I like to think of myself as a fairly average consumer, as a gamer.
Okay.
I seem to, like, I have, my opinions seem to generally coincide with the general opinions of the masses. I purchase things that a lot of people purchase, and I seem to go with trends and things like that. Things people like, I seem to like as well. So whenever I think I'm going to do something, I imagine there's other people like me out there who are also going to do it. And maybe I'm crazy and I'm a weird, you know, I'm the only person who's, whatever, doesn't matter. But, so I'm going to use this as an example. You've seen this game, Steep. The snowboarding game. When it got announced, I was like, okay, cool, a snowboarding game. That looks interesting. I used to play snowboarding games back in the day because, you know, they were cool. You know, like N64 and GameCube, and there's a couple even on like last gen 360 and PS3 that were fun. And it's kind of strange now, but like these sort of extreme sports games, extreme sports in general, really got less popular. So maybe that's it. But extreme sports games used to be really cool, and and a lot of fun. And so I was thinking about it, I was like, man, I used to play snowboarding games, like 1080X and stuff like that, and I don't anymore. And that's kind of weird. But I saw Steep, and I was like, cool, a snowboarding game. I'm never going to play that, but that's cool. But then I saw it was coming to Switch, and I was like, you know, I wouldn't have got that before, but the fact that I can play it anywhere, like, kind of makes me want to get it. And I think, that's a selling point. Like, whatever third-party game comes to it, unless it's, like, completely horrendously ported, I'm probably going to want to get it on Switch. Because the advantage of being able to just play it all the time, wherever I'm doing, you know, wherever I'm going, whatever I'm doing, I get to have that game right there with me. That's a really big advantage for me. And I do play a lot of 3DS and some Vita, but I'm a big portable guy, so maybe I'm a little separate in that. But like, so my point is like Steep, I would have never bought it in a million years on my Xbox. Yeah. I have a lot of games on my Xbox. That doesn't need to be one of them. Never gonna play it. But as I think about it more, I'm like, man, I kind of want to buy Steep because I used to like snowboarding games. A snowboarding game sounds cool. And that game is supposed to be pretty good. And so I don't know. Maybe I don't know if you agree with that or not, or maybe you have a.
No, it's the same thing like on Vita. It's where here's a game that comes out, and this certain crowd, you know, there's not a lot of them, but they're a very hardcore crowd, and they're like, well, you came to our system, there's not a lot out, we'll support you, and, you know, people make money just porting games to Vita because people will buy it. It'll be the same thing with Switch. They're like, all right, there's not tons of third party, but here's a cool game, I'm kind of interested, I'm going to buy it here because I like to support the system. Like, people are going to be making money off of that.
And I think, I don't think you're going to be able to get, you know, like a lot of the huge, big budget titles, because they probably won't sell the best there anyway. But I think a lot of, you know, the smaller, AAA games, and I'm sure less graphically intense ones, I can see finding themselves to Switch, and the Switch audience wanting to get them because... Not only would be what I'm sure they'd be starred for third parties, and they probably want them just because of that, but also, you know, there's very clear advantages. Now, there is disadvantages, you know, if you play on it. We established it's probably going to be a second console, and you don't get your trophies or achievements, you know, if it's online, you're not playing online with your other people who have Xboxes or PlayStations. But the idea of, taking it wherever you go, I think that outweighs a lot of the negatives of, you know, what a third party game has to offer.
Yeah, and obviously you will see people taking like, hey, I want to play some 2K, I don't know, let me just play a little My Career, I'll just take it on the go with me. Mm-hmm. Let me just play a couple games while I'm, you know, out doing whatever.
Exactly.
Like I said, kids, you know, it's also not a terrible price. $300 isn't terrible. So I could see like a lot of like younger kids, or like you're out to eat with your parents, like, shut up, Timmy, play your Skyrim, whatever, just sit over here and play your game. So I can see the portable side definitely being a selling point for a certain crowd of people. So people who support that or the developers who support it are probably gonna get some decent sales out of it. We'll hope so.
And then I think my last more positive point, and I do want to get this out there because a lot of people. This is another thing I don't hear a lot. Now, that last one was more opinionated. This one is a lot more factual in my head. But you discussed the Wii U and how there was a lot of gaps, like blatant, like just ghost filled gaps, and there was.
Yeah.
And I talked about it on a previous episode, but I want to hit this point home now that the Switch is a lot more closer and we have so much more information on it. Is the 3DS is going to die very, very soon.
Mm.
Like, I think it's going to get supported up through the year, and then they're going to cut it off. And then you're going to have your Nintendo, and that's it. It's not your mobile, it's not your console or your handheld. It's neither in both. It's just the Nintendo. And I believe it was about, maybe it was 2 years ago, I remember this Nintendo, and it should have been probably a much bigger telling than maybe people noticed, but they had merged their mobile and their console
the divisions, yeah.
Yeah. And the specifically their development divisions for making games. And if you look, like, as I had a 3DS and a Wii U, and if you look at the lineups, you would have big droughts in Wii U, but you'd have 3DS stuff. And then you'd have big droughts in 3DS, and then you'd have some Wii U stuff. And I think, like, assuming it doesn't take these, you know, I mean, sure, it'll take longer to make the Switch games because, you know, just it's higher fidelity stuff. They're going to be bigger games because it's a more powerful console. But I think that combined development effort of the Wii U and the 3DS, because if you put those libraries together, aside from the overlay of the games that were made for both, it's actually a very steady stream. And I think if you get that steady stream on the Switch, even with a lack of third-party support, you're going to have a lot more constant flow. I think this first year is rough because I don't think they are... You know, I think they are trying to just kind of get it out there, and they're putting out stuff that they have and they can. And I'm hoping that they have a longer roadmap that they show at E3. But on the presentation, they were like, look, these are the games for the most part that you're going to play this year. And, you know, there may not be a million of them, but most of them are going to be really good, and they're all coming out, you know, by this holiday season. So... Mm-hmm. All these games you're going to play very soon. And then I hope at E3... So, you, like, that show is just what you have to look forward to in the immediate future. And I hope E3 is like, look at all the things that are coming that you can look forward to. Like, you know, Pokemon and Metroid and, I don't know, a new, like, Mario Maker for the Switch or a new 2D Mario or, you know, whatever. Nintendo stuff.
And I mean, they could almost do it like... how Xbox and PlayStation do it, where it's like, you got your retail $60 games, and then there's also like, here's your downloadable stuff, which you wouldn't put on a disc, but it's like $20 or $30 or $40, and that's what the 3DS stuff was, and you just put it as the downloadable, or like the smaller, like you could have your 3DS or, you know, smaller kind of games and still have the $60 AAA games, and have them both on the same system, so there's always stuff on the system.
And you have your you can have your big Marios and Metroids and Zeldas, and then put your Kirbys, you know, like, here, just spend $30, get a Kirby game, you know, get a Yoshi game or whatever, and not to downplay those, I love Yoshi and Kirby, but just on a production level, they're not as high.
No.
So.
And they work perfectly on the go, and they work just fine on the TV, like mm-hmm. that's... Like I said, that make that your Xbox Live Arcade or your PSN is that you're used mm-hmm. to be 3DS titles, and just make that, keep making them, and just
exactly.
Like, here you go, buy on the same system.
So my point I wanted to get out there was that the people who think like the first party is gonna fail you, like the Vita is wildly successful from a software point of view, and that's with no first party support. Now it has a pretty illustrious third party support in smaller games. But it has, like, zero first-party. Now, with Nintendo, they have, like, the best first-parties there is, and they're only making games, I believe, after this year for one machine. And every single... Yeah, so I think that's... Even without the third parties, it's going to suck, but I think you're going to have a fairly steady stream of quality products
mm-hmm.
on this machine.
We can just hope. We just hope, because If they fail at this one, I don't know, but I think that they can get it together.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's going to do well. I think it I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think it can't not do that well. For no. One is the second is I'm a firm believer in this. The second you put a real Pokemon game on this, it's going to sell like hotcakes, like you said earlier.
Okay. Like Kylan, who doesn't like Nintendo, is like, yeah. If they put Pokemon on there, I will buy it for Pokemon. Like, that's a lot of people. A lot of people will do that.
And, like, they will, the second a exclusive real Pokemon game comes out on that machine, you're probably going to sell 3 to 5 million units.
Yeah, for sure. I guarantee that, like I said, I'll be one of the, me and 10 people behind me would all be like, yep, I will pay. By then, there might be like a bundle. Or it might be like a small price cut, like $275 for Pokemon and a Switch. I'm in there.
A nice special edition or something like that.
Yep. And we'll do it. Like I said, I'll do it. I 100% will do it.
Because I have a friend of mine, I forget his name now. He doesn't listen to the show, so he won't get mad at me. I think it's Kevin.
Let's go with
Kevin. Kenneth. It's Kenneth. I have a friend of mine named Kenneth. He's a very good friend of mine. I feel like an asshole because I forgot his name. I have a good friend of mine named Kenneth, and he didn't care about the 3DS at all. Like, just, you know, nothing mattered. It was a piece, like, not a piece of crap, but, you know, they could have put anything on it. Didn't care. And the second they put out Pokemon, he bought it. He bought Pokemon. It was the X and Y, and that's all he played all the time, nonstop.
Yeah. That's all it takes. Anybody who was born in the 90s, that's all it takes.
So, I think a lot of people underestimate how valuable that's going to be. Because even if, like, this thing is a piece of shit that no one cares about and no one's buying, the selling power of Pokemon is more powerful than how shitty this could possibly be.
Absolutely, dude. Like, that's, like I said, if they get that out in year 1.5 or whatever, they're good.
And also, I think another big selling feature is, like, just the idea that you can show it to people. Like, we're talking about kids, you know, playing, like, they can go take that to school and show their friends and be like, hey, look at this, you know, I'm playing Mario Kart. You want to play Mario Kart? And then those kids go home and, you know, be like, hey, my friend freaking brought a game system to school and we played Mario Kart. Where's mine, Mom? And like that, it's not, you know, it's more powerful of word of mouth because you are experiencing it for yourself, and you get, like I was talking about with Switch, you get that, or 1-2 Switch, I mean, you get that enjoyment, you get that positive experience with it right there. It's tangible. You get it and you feel it, and then you walk away going, I want to do that. I want to experience that. And that makes you want to switch. Now, does it make you want to spend the $300? Who knows? We'll see. But, like, there's nothing but positive things can come from, you know, people showing it off to other people. And it's not like an Xbox where I can be like, oh, I was playing Call of Duty the other day. It was cool. And they're like, yeah, that's great. But if I'm like, yo, look, play Call of Duty. If I was able to give someone my Xbox and be like, play Call of Duty right now, they'd be like, oh, this is awesome. You know?
Yeah. Like I said, we'll see how it all goes. But what else we got on our list, my man?
Yeah. Sorry, I get a little crazy.
Oh, there you go. I know you love Nintendo. it's all good.
My bad things are the online is stupid. Everything is terrible with that.
If that thing is like $19.99 a year.
Yeah.
Okay. If that thing is like $30-$40, I'm like, nah, dog, I'm good.
I talked about this on the show because that was the reaction show, and that's the only negative I talked about then. I have some more now, but we need to hurry. Or you're on a time limit, so I need to.
Yeah, you're all good.
But the one that's still, like, the only game that I'm looking forward to playing online is Splatoon, and that comes out when the internet's still free. So yeah. I will play Splatoon.
That for a month and you're good.
Yeah, if this costs more than $30 a year, then I will play Splatoon until it's not free anymore, and I will never touch it again. Yep. And I'm perfectly okay with that, because their system is so terrible that and unless they start giving those games to me for free or to own, because as you may or may not know, listener, you get a similar to Games of Gold or PlayStation Plus, you get a game. It's an NES or Super Nintendo game. The Super Nintendo games have online multiplayer, which is cool. But you only get it for a month, and then you lose it. Now, you're really not losing that much money if you just say you can have it. Those games are like $5 each, you know?
Yeah, exactly. You've already bought them three times probably anyways.
And if they come out and say, like, Virtual Console is back... Like, I'm hoping that they say Virtual Console is backwards compatible. And if you have a Virtual Console game on Wii U, it'll transfer over. Still holding out hope for that. I know I'm going to get my hopes crushed, but I'm hoping. But a lot of people are going to own those games in the first place. The ones who are going to pay for your thing. So you're not really losing money on them. And really, if you're charging someone, you know, that much for the service, and the other parts of the service also suck, giving them that free game is going to make them want to buy it.
Like, PSA, the PSN sucks, but they give you a bunch of free exactly. games, so people put up with it.
I don't even play my PlayStation online. If I do online, I either use my PC or my Xbox, because I don't like doing it, but I still buy PlayStation Plus, because I get so many free games, it's worth it. That is a game subscription to me. It is not an online subscription, and... If it was the same thing on Nintendo, I'd be more than happy to give them as much money as they asked for. Now that's not as much, but you know, you can understand what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. We'll see how much the price is. That's what it all depends on.
So that's all right. So power down on Nintendo. Cool.
That's all good.
Take a breather. All right. So next thing I want to talk about, because I'm insanely excited about this, is Crystal Dynamics, Square Enix, and Square Enix announced that Crystal Dynamics and Square Enix, or Eidos Montreal, which Crystal Dynamics is the people who made the Tomb Raider reboot and Tomb Raider, Rise of the Tomb Raider, which are the two of the greatest third person action adventure games ever made, and they are better than Uncharted.
Gameplay, absolutely.
Yeah, they are. If anyone hears that, they're going to get mad at me. Good thing no one listens to the show, right, Adam? but they are better than Uncharted. And Eidos Montreal makes the... what are they called? The Deus Ex
games. Did they make Hitman?
No,
they didn't make Hitman.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, they make the... I don't know who makes Hitman. They may. Who knows? But they
It's another Eidos, or Eidos, I think it is. But yeah,
Deus Ex. And I hear they're very good. I have some friends who love them, and I hear they're awesome, but I haven't played them. But
Human Revolution is amazing.
They are going to make a Avengers game, which is going...
Marvel's Avengers official MCU, I believe?
Yeah. Well, I think, you know... Well, not. I don't know if it's MCU, but I know it's like... Because the way their video game properties work, they only own the MCU characters. Sort of like how there's not going to be X-Men in Marvel's Capcom 4.
Yeah.
So, I don't know if it's going to be directly tied to the MCU, or if it's just going to be, like, you're only going to have your Iron Man and, you know, Captain America and Black Widow and Hawkeye and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But it's going to be... Now, as you know, I'm a big DC guy by the statues that are in front of you. I do love DC more than Marvel, because they're far superior in every way. But that being said, I still do really like Marvel. And there is no other... Take away Batman. There is no good superhero games. And that hurts me so much as a
giant... Like Marvel superheroes.
You know, Sebastian said that to me. And I said, no, that is a good Lego game with superheroes in it. That is not a good superhero game.
But yeah, you're right. There's a lot of movie tie-in ones that weren't great. Spider-Man 2 is amazing, but outside of that, you're right. There's not a lot of good stuff.
Even the last Spider-Man games like suck.
After Web of Shattered Dimensions, I was like, these are all terrible.
And like the best superhero games are like not superhero games. They're like Infamous, which is a superhero game, but you know. I want there to be... that's why I'm crazy excited for that new Spider-Man game. Now I own a PlayStation, but I'm still a little salty that it's PlayStation exclusive. Because I'm like, man, I do like my Xbox more than my PlayStation.
Yeah, I'm with you.
But I'm still going to get it, but I'm just like, man, I wish I could have that on my Xbox. Achievements are cool. But Oh my god, I fucking love Tomb Raider. The reboots specifically, like, that is my, like, I do this thing where, and I when I play a video game that I really, really like, especially like a single player one, and I just enjoy it a lot, like ridiculously a lot. It's hard to describe how much I have to like a video game to do this. I will purposely only play small pieces of it throughout the course of like years.
Just take a long time on it.
Yeah. Like, I still, like, Sunset Overdrive is one of my favorite games ever made. And I only recently was like, I can beat the game now, and it's because I bought the DLC, so I have more to play after that.
Okay.
Because I know it's weird, and I get...
No, it makes it. You want to make it last.
Okay. Exactly. You know, I want to make it last. So, like, Tomb Raider, I beat Tomb Raider whenever Rise of the Tomb Raider got announced, because I was like, okay, I get to play more Tomb Raider. And then I played, like, Rise of the Tomb Raider, and I had to stop myself, and, like, every now and again, I'll go back, and I'll play a little bit more, and I'm like, ugh, it's so good. It's so good.
It's so good. That's my game of the year that year that game came out, because it's so good.
It's so fucking great. So, yeah. The idea of them making a superhero game, and, you know, is just... I want to know, like, what it's going to be, because they say it's, like, Avengers.
That's what I'm confused about, is, like, because Tomb Raider and Deus Ex, while they're, you know, Tomb Raider has your supernatural, and Deus Ex is, like, cyborgs or whatever, it's still kind of gross. Like, there's no people who fly around and have giant hammers. And,
it's not
like,
crazy.
Big green guy. Yeah, so I'm curious how they're going to, or, like, even what kind of game it's going to be.
Yeah,
it's like,
that's, I'm like, they're both single-player games, and you play as one character. Are they going to have, like, pieces where you play as Thor and pieces where you play as Iron Man?
And, I feel like it has to be open world, like, how do you have, like a linear sort of a game, and you're the, like, you can fly, like, it doesn't really, like, I don't know how they're gonna do it, but I'm really, it looks really, like, I'm hyped for it, like, because Marvel, once Disney bought Marvel, they, like, took all the rights back to all the things, and, like, we're not gonna just license out and just make shitty games, we're only gonna do when we feel like we're gonna do a good game, and this is what they're invested in, so.
And, like, in my opinion, you know, with Tomb Raider, you have one of, like, the best studios that you can have make, you know, a character-driven action game like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, man, I can't fucking wait. That's going to be so good. I can't wait till they tell us more. I don't think they had any form of, like, even, like, release window or even information thing like that.
No, I think it was, like, you'll learn more next year or some nonsense like that.
I'm hoping at, like, E3... Because, if you think about it, man, Tomb Raider came out, what, like, 2 years ago, right? Or a year and a half ago?
It didn't come out this last holiday, but the one before that.
Yeah. So, a little over a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
So, they've probably been working on it, you know, for, like...
I mean, they've been working on it for at least, like, 1.5-ish years, 1 year and a couple months.
Yeah. So... I want them to give me, like... an idea of what it is, maybe at E3 or sometime this year, but I want to know what it is really bad, because I can't get my head around how you make an Avengers game. Like, I get a Batman, an Iron Man, you know, a Spider-Man game, you're playing as that character, but how do you make a team game, you know,
like, yeah, unless it's maybe like with Battlefield 1, where you just played a campaign of different people, like their entire story, and like they meet up at the end to be the Avengers, possibly.
That'd be really cool, actually. Like the movies where you play a Thor story and then an Iron Man story, mm-hmm. and then the end of it, it's like one big thing. Maybe you can like switch between the characters or something.
Yeah,
that sounds dope.
So I'm looking at the story right now. Yeah, like there's absolutely more details on the Avenger project and other games will be announced in 2018. So we probably won't see anything at E3.
Yep, you were right. That sucks. Why would they even show that to us?
I don't know.
I'm sad. Assholes.
But either way, like maybe we'll get like another small trailer at E3 or something. But like I said, because Deus Ex came out this past, I think it was like August or September. And the Tomb Raider was a year and like a half ago, so they've been probably deep into it for a little while. So maybe 2019, maybe middle 2020. I mean, that's a way to go, but I'm excited for it.
Yeah.
Whatever it ends up being.
All right. I just remembered something else I want to talk about, but now it escapes.
What is that? Go ahead. Do you remember?
I'm trying. Oh, I remember. Injustice 2.
Yeah.
Do you big Injustice guy? You like Injustice?
Yeah, I loved Injustice 1. I mean, I read the comic. I don't even read comics, but I read that comic, and then I played the hell out of that game. So.
Holy shit, man. Like, Injustice 1, I'm trying to think, but, like, that was the last time I remember off the top of my head where, like, a game that, like, took over not only my life, but, like, every other person that I knew. Mm-hmm. Like, every friend that I had who had an Xbox was playing Injustice. We were all fighting each other. I was just going to, like, everyone's houses. I remember I went crazy with that game. Like, bad. I bought two of those big fight sticks they made for the game.
That's extremely expensive fight sticks.
Yeah, I bought two of them on Xbox, and then I bought one of them on PlayStation, because I was like, well, if I play it on PlayStation, I want to have the fight stick. And I don't even ever use them. They're, like, in my closet. And I don't even know if I still have my PlayStation 1. I may have given it away. But,
yeah.
Like, my point is...
Games are legit.
Yeah, I fucking love Injustice 1. And
especially the story mode. That's, like, a really good fighting game story mode.
Have you seen the stuff about Injustice 2 that's come out recently?
I haven't watched too much about it. No, I've been trying to kind of stay away. But you can tell me, like, it's
going to be cool. No, it's not going to be, like, anything spoilery. They haven't announced any new characters. They announced there's... three editions you can buy as of right now. There's the standard edition, which is just the game. There's a digital deluxe edition, which I think is kind of weird the way they did this. There's a digital deluxe edition. It's the game, three DLC characters, a shader, because the game has, like, this gear system now. I don't know if you're aware of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then the shaders are, like, you know, they're armor shaders for the cosmetic, which they did a live stream recently that I watched that was really cool, because they had a Batman that was all dark and gray and black, and then they had one with a shader on that was the bright blue and yellow, like, 60s, and I was like, oh, that's so fucking cool. Because I was like, shaders, that's dumb, and then I saw a blue and yellow Batman and couldn't control myself, so...
You're like, I'm in.
Yeah, I'm in, all in. So you get this exclusive shader, and then a skin. Now, they called them premiere skins. And I guess they're going to have, like, normal skins like you have in Injustice or Mortal Kombat, and these premiere skins change everything about a character to make them another character, but they are the same.
It's like the Supergirl to Power Girl.
Exactly. That's it. So it turns Supergirl into Power Girl. Now, Supergirl and Power Girl are, like, the same. I think they're literally the same person. Power Girl is just the grown-up version. So they have the same powers, so it's kind of ridiculous to make another character that just has the same exact powers. But this complete reskin, I think it's, like, different voice acting, or maybe not for her, but the gear looks different and stuff like that. So I thought that was dope. And then they have the Ultimate Edition, which is 9 DLC characters, 2 exclusive shaders, including the one from the Digital Deluxe, and then 3 of these skins, one turning Green Lantern into Jon Stewart, which is the Black Green Lantern.
That's what I want. Yeah, Jon Stewart's my guy.
Yeah, he's the shit. And then Flash into Reverse Flash, which is pretty sick.
So I haven't looked this up, but is there no Batman that turns him into Thomas Wayne? Because that would be amazing.
You know, see, that's the thing. As I think, like, that, it would just be, like, your normal skin. Like,
yeah.
Because, I guess you need to make him sound a bit gruffer, you know?
Yeah.
But
so make him older.
Yeah. But, like, that's, you know, just, like, a different costume, whereas, you know, if the Flash sounds exactly like the Reverse Flash, then you're like, okay, that's just, he's yellow. Okay. So, I mean, you know, they haven't really showed how it works 100%. This is just based on kind of stuff I've read, so we'll see what that is. But I think that's cool.
It sounds pretty cool. I know some people were mad. They're like, you have to pre-order to get Dark. So I'm like, if you've ever played any Mortal Kombat or any Injustice, all the pre-order bonuses and all this, but they're all going to become available later. Like, if you literally wait 9 months, you'll get a Game of the Year edition. That has everything. So, like,
right? Like, just wait a little bit, and you'll have everything, and you'll pay way less money for it. Calm down.
Yeah, exactly. People are always like, oh, I'm so mad. I'm like, I get it. It makes sense if, like, you're not going to be able to play Darkseid for, like, the first couple months, but he's going to be there. Don't freak out.
But now this is now they said it's going to have the largest initial roster as well as the largest DLC roster. Now, I did a little research on this, and Right now, it has 31 characters, including Darkseid.
Okay.
So 30 total, and then the Darkseid is the DLC. Oh, wait, no, I forget. Scratch that. 31 characters, not including Darkseid. I'm sorry.
Okay.
31 initial characters on the disc. And that's according, like, if you go on their website, they have all of the characters they announced, and then, like, silhouettes of the ones they haven't yet.
That's the DLC ones, or is that just
unannounced? That's the unannounced ones. And if you go through and count them all, it's 31. And then, which is huge. I think Injustice 1 was, like, I think I looked it up, it was, like, 28, including DLC, or it was 30 including DLC. So, like, the base game is going to have either more or the same amount of characters as Injustice 1 with all of its DLC.
Okay.
And then your 9 DLC characters, according to the Ultimate Edition, and then Darkseid. Okay. Now, this is what I thought was interesting, is they said it's the largest initial roster, which is 31 characters, which may be, well, it's definitely bigger than Mortal Kombat. Now, the thing is, I think it's because NetherRealm Studios is now a separate entity than what it used to be. Because I remember they put out that one on, like, PS2 that had, like, 60 characters. You remember that?
Something ridiculous.
Yeah, it was something ridiculous, and they were all, it wasn't great. But
yeah.
I think they're, like, a different independent studio now, their own, it's weird.
Or I think, like, they rebranded from Warner Brother and, like, started their own, yeah.
Yeah, so it is the largest of NetherRealm Studios. Mm-hmm. But this is what I thought was interesting. As it stands, they have the 9 DLC, and then the 10th being Darkseid, which is the pre-order bonus. But for argument's sake, the season pass is 9 characters.
Mm-hmm.
As it stands, that would make it on par with the DLC of Mortal Kombat, which had 2 seasons of 5 and 5. You had 5 yep. DLC characters 1 year, next year you had another 5. So, but if it has the largest DLC roster as well as the largest roster, that would mean that your first season of DLC is 9 characters, and then you'll have a second season of probably, like, 9 more characters, which is fucking insane. And I thought
they're pulling out people that you've never even heard of before.
I'm looking forward to that. That Larflees. Go look up Larflees if you don't know who Larflees is. He's dope.
Oh, what's the little small demon guy? Can't remember his name. Like, he says his name and turns into a demon or some nonsense. I can't remember. He got cursed by a witch. I don't know. It was on Justice League. I don't remember his name.
There's one, I think I know who you're talking about, but he goes by, he has, like, this demonic name, but then everyone just calls him the demon, because it's, like, something the demon, and then everyone just calls him demon.
Yeah. It'll be a good roster. Dope. I mean, let's be honest, the last, like, 3 games they made have been really good. Like, when they rebooted Mortal Kombat with 9, they didn't call it 9, but it was 9.
Yeah.
And then Injustice, and then Mortal Kombat X, and it's like, I just expect this to be just as good, so.
And
it'll be really good.
As a huge DC fan and fighting game fan, the idea of I'm going to have, like, maybe, like, 50 characters, but are actually all really good, you know, and not the, you know, a bunch of, like, crappy clones and stuff like that, like they had in that one for PS2. That's super interesting to me, and I fucking can't wait.
That comes out in May, I believe. Mm-hmm. The May is going on right now.
And
we're about to go on pretty soon.
Yeah, I think if you they've been sending out codes, and I'm really mad because I haven't gotten any. And I'm going to go break into Ed Boon's house and tell him to give me a code, because I need that shit. And last thing I want to talk about is... And this is a very small thing, is I am crazy fucking excited for Sea of Thieves.
Yes, absolutely. And I can tell from your Twitter for a while. Or from your Twitter feed.
All I do is I retweet Sea of Thieves all the time. I talk about Sea of Thieves. I can't wait. And now what I want to do is I'm going to have a pirate ship.
Okay.
And I'm going to be a captain. And it's going to be awesome. But... we need to have just a big old, like, a fleet of, you know, everybody who, like, listens to all of our shows, a giant podcast fleet taking over the high seas, killing everybody. It's gonna be so fucking cool.
We could probably get at least 3 completely manned ships, I believe. Some of the people that I know that podcast that are Xbox guys, I think we can get at least 3 completely decked out, like, fully, whatever the big ships are called. Frigadiers, yeah, or whatever.
3 full frigadiers running shit, and it's going to be dope. Okay. And I just,
the game, it looks great.
I just wanted to point that out there, that I can't wait for it. I'm very excited. It's coming up. And they've been putting out like these technical alphas that I'm signed up for. And I'm really hoping I get into it just because I want to play that game so bad.
Yeah, let me know how it is, man. That looks really good. I'm really that's probably going to be my big fall game. If it's not like Destiny, if it's not grindy, I'm into it. That's the only thing I'm worried about. But if they show me it's not grindy, I'm into it.
I liked Destiny, though.
I
see what you mean, though. Like, I don't want to sit there and play the same thing. It doesn't seem like more mission-based because it's like seems more open world.
That's what I'm saying. If you're like, hey, here's a map, go find it. Here's a mission. Yeah. If it's like that, that's cool. If it's the same,
find some stuff and get loot, not play a mission 100 times.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm hoping it's good. I don't think that this is going to be that kind of game. So I'm really looking forward to it, too. I'm right there with you.
And after after they canceled Scalebound, I was pretty bummed about that. Because I'm just a big co-op guy. I love co-op, especially for, like, you know, more single-player stuff like that, like PvE. And I was, like, I was really excited for both of them independently because I was like, man, what a good year on Xbox for co-op. And then they canceled one half of the games I was excited about. And I was like, well, but that just made me, like, more excited for Sea of Thieves because I'm like, I still have you.
Yep. Get that Crackdown 3.
Yep. Oh, that does have online. I never played Crackdown, though. I don't know.
First one was really good. We'll see how this one turns out.
I think, is it backwards compatible? Do you know? If it is, I'll pick it up.
I don't know. Probably. I would assume so.
If it's not, it will be soon.
Yeah. But yeah, by the time that one comes out, it will.
I can get a like GameStop for like $4, so.
Yeah.
I'll give it a shot. Mm-hmm. All right. Is there anything you want to talk about?
No, man, I think I'm good for tonight. I'll probably get back on here or have you on my show. We'll talk some more. But it's good to talk some games. I haven't done it in a long time. So.
All right. Now, don't
really appreciate it.
It was my honor to have you on. Now, don't leave yet because, as you know, do you listen to, like, the entire show? Because they're really, really long, and I wouldn't hold it against you if you stopped, like.
No, I listened to the whole thing.
Okay.
I'm at work pretending to work, so it's all good.
So one thing that I have to do at every show is I have to shout out the Mic Kings. And even though one of them's here, I have to do it.
Weird.
I have to do it, Adam. It's my job.
Right. Well,
so if you didn't know, I have this one fan named Adam Gumbert. And he's just the best. Coolest dude ever. You should do a podcast with him because it's really fun.
That sounds like an asshole.
Yeah, right? Fuck Adam Gumbert. Fuck Sebastian and fuck Adam Gumbert. But he does a show a lot more regular and maybe even better than ours. Probably better than ours. And he just talks about his life with his friends. So follow them on Twitter at the Mic Kings. And it's a really good time. Listen to their show. Follow Kylon at Kylon. Like Lon, like
K-Y-Lon.
D_Warner. And then I don't know anyone else's Twitter handle, because so those are the only ones I say.
Yeah.
And he has constantly supported us, and I truly think I found it strange because I don't really like talking to people online. It's strange because I like doing podcasts and stuff like that, but like it's very strange that I've, in my opinion at least, I seem to have found a friend in you that like, and I don't really, you know, I don't really ever talk to anybody. So it's kind of weird that, you know, I don't know, but...
No, I'm right there with you, man. You guys have always been great. I've always loved listening. I like to give you shit because I want you to do more stuff. But
well, we are assholes.
I found you guys... Yeah, that's sure. No, I love you. I found you guys randomly, and I enjoy the stuff, so...
So, Adam Gumby, best dude ever. Go listen to his show. Thank you for watching or listening to the Social Nerdcast Episode 8. Is it 8? Maybe it's 9.
I think it's 9.
Yeah. Episode 9. Thank you for watching and listening. Episode 9. Follow us on Twitter at @social_nerds. Remember that we are all social nerds. That's the mantra of us. Every one of us out there who is talking to people, making friends, and loving comic books, movies, and video games. We're all social nerds. And if you're not social enough, well, you know, that's okay. Go talk to people, make friends, because we all have the same interests. Even people you don't think, you know, even if you're like, oh, that guy looks like an asshole, I bet there's something, everybody likes something, and a lot of people like the same stuff. That's why it's cool. So, you know, I bet you have something in common with them. We're all social nerds, everyone in the world. I have the largest podcast cast because it's the globe. And if you want to get on my show, talk to me for a long time and befriend me on social media, and you could be on this small television. Thank you for watching. I said follows on Twitter, right? Yeah, @social_nerds. Yep. I also always say this. No one else even knows how to log in to Twitter. So that is just like my personal Twitter. I try to run it sort of as the Social Nerds Twitter. Don't let everyone else hear that, because they'll get mad at me for that voting thing.
Dude, I mean, like, no one else has the Mike King's information except for me. Right. So I run that Twitter.
I don't know if you've done the same thing, but I've told them like a million times. And I'm like, just go log on and you can post stuff. It's fine.
No, I ain't told them. I completely keep it secret.
So, but like, I try not to post like personal stuff on there. Well, you know, like I try to keep it. I mean, I do post personal opinions, but you know, it's not like a personal Twitter and my life and stuff like that. It's just, I keep it social nerd based. So follow me on Twitter there. Talk to me there. I always talk back because I have nothing better to do. We have an Instagram, and I do nothing but post memes on it all the time. So that's
the most dank memes.
The dankest memes. If you're ready for that dank, you can follow us at, I think it's the Social Nerd 64 on that. And it's just dank memes all day, 24/7. I don't know how to make a Facebook page. I tried.
Don't do it. I mean, I have one, and I stopped posting to it because I just find no need. I prefer Twitter.
I like Facebook for like my social media, and then but for the social nerds, Twitter's like the best.
Yeah, I agree.
Anyway, so you know the sign off we do? All right.
I get my finger guns ready to snap.
You got your finger guns? All right. And as always, stay nerdy.
Stay nerdy.
Stay nerdy.
Stay nerdy.
Wait, so we're gonna do, we did the finger guns, so right, 3, 2, 1,
stay nerdy.
Damn it. All right, fuck it. That's fine. Where the hell's the stop button on this thing? I can't see the mouse all the way over here.